Nice to see you again. Well, I've done it more than when we first came. There's about six of us. Can't be beneath your feet. You know, you're walking downtown, you're walking along Victoria Street, and you think, well, you're walking on the road, but actually, you're actually walking on water, the full width. Because one culvert is 29 feet wide, and the other one is 12 foot. So it's not much wider than that. Oh yeah, but you've got two culverts. Walk down Albert Street, you're completely underwater because the sides of the buildings go straight down culverts. So it's and it's a sewers actually. You know. And go back to 1850. And in 1850, Derby was a right dump. You know, particularly around the Cathedral Quarter. You know, you won't believe it. I mean, we now think about the Cathedral Quarter being marvellous. But in 1850, it was shocking. And Cressy wrote a report about the area. And I'm not going to read it because it'll be another time. But if you ever want to look at it, it's, get it in the local study library. It's a public health map. There were people in there. There was in Walker Lane. Remember Walker Lane?
Yes.
That's where Cathedral Road is today. Just from there to the top to the bottom, there's 166 dwellings in that road alone. 66 frontage and over 100 courts. Some of the courts, some of the rooms, they've got 18 people living in the rooms. And of course, typhoid and all those was then. And people were dying, being taken out by dinner time, and the bed was rented again by tea time because of that many people coming. Lots of Irish people and that in them days coming in. And it was shocking. It was even the next door they got pigs, animals in the place. Sewage was coming out, obviously the full report here, sewage was coming through the walls into the, and of course there's no drains, only cesspits. Cesspits were full. And Walker Lane goes down to the bottom into Bowl Lane. At the bottom there, you've got the Mark Eaton Brook. Mm-hmm. And of course, stepping stones, I told you stepping stones were there. He found stepping stones, it was a disgrace, he said. Stepping stones in the yard over the sewage. Mm-hmm. And it's running down the road into the brook mm-hmm. at the bottom. People were slaughterhouses up in the West End, where it is now, killing animals, all sorts come down there. Everything that people have got to get rid of went in the brook. So it was just a sewage, and they've got to do something about it. And the only thing they could do about it, really, was to cover it up. So what they decided to do was to get, I think they got 200 Irishmen, about 1850, and what they did is started down toward the council house, and they just built a brick and a half thick, just a wall. They put timbers up and put a brick and a half, and that was it. And that was where, and traffic had got to go on the top of that. But no heavy vehicles in them days, or some carts. But it wasn't very good. Took the timbers out, and some deaths. We got fatalities off the men getting killed in there. So it was a bit of a rough job. And you'll see, when I had the job, to work on the job in 1954, 55 and 56, you'll see, I'll show you the wall that it was. And we got trams on the top, and buses on the top, and you can understand why no buses went in when you see what I show you, because it was all timbered up with. We used to go down there regular, timbering up. But sewers, when talking about sewers, how I got into sewers was during the war. My dad was a drainage bloke for Derby. He was a foreman. In them days, the foreman was a top bloke. Below them, they had gangers, and so we had so many gangs. With everybody being in the army, my dad was short of men. And if we got to clean sewers out, and it was all maintenance during the war, my dad used to say, right, you and John, two oldest. I was one of nine lads, so you can tell, you're the oldest, come on. And if you didn't, you go, wallop in them days. And I said, what do you want, Dad? And it was just natural to do. He says, get through that blubbing sewer. And we had such a crawl, some of the sewers, because in those days there wasn't pipes, there were bricks, as I'll show you, brickwork. And they were about so big, a man couldn't get through. So he made us We had a coal bag. Remember the old coal bags we used to get? That was them to get through, to pull a rope through. And when they got a rope through from one manhole to the other manhole, you've got men in there and men in here. Then you pull another rope with a cornet on, a big cornet. And don't forget, we'd gone through all the slop and silt and that to get there. And then you pull these cornets backwards and forwards, tipped them up into buckets, up it went. And that's how you clean the sewers. And that's the maintenance we did. And I was actually doing that, and I was troubled. Not cleaning the sewers out, but going through to put the rope through. Timing.
Did you get typhoid or anything like that?
Well, there was some things, public health and health and safety was you've got to get it done. It's a job you've got to do. I mean, I've been on jobs here. I can remember going out during the war in Bloomfield Street and a bombing. Top of Bloomfield Street on Hodgkinson Road, there's a bombing there. My dad says, come on. Took us out there to help him. Because you've got no help, you see. You could do little things, go and fetch that shovel, go and fetch that. And it was like working, didn't get paid. And I can remember a policeman coming to me and saying, home. But he didn't know I was with my dad. And when I came out of school in Ford Street, I don't even know where the arches was, the railway. Mm-hmm. We've got a relief corps in there. So if you go down Brook Walk, you see the weir. You look around the corner, there's a weir goes round. That goes into another corbett. And the gates used to be down. And that one used to be winding. Mm-hmm. And me and my brother, every night during the war, and I was only, 12, 13, my brother was 14, we used to both be winding this gate every night at 4:30 to put the gate down. So the brook came up, and along the weir, we had to put sandbags in the gap, because there was a gap laid that wide, and Brook Walk was full to the top, where if you walk along today, it's about 4 feet, but that used to fill right up, because the sandbags on the weir filled it up, and that was for the ARP during the war, the fire brigade. There are pipes from there running along the streets, you know, up into the cathedral area. But if you don't remember, you break your neck. Do you remember them? Anyone remember them? The pipes used to be on the roads. That was water supply for the centre. So that if big mains got blown up, you've got water coming out, the brook's pumping. Anyway, let's get on to sewage. I'll show you some of that. That's all right. That's all right. That. Now this is actually pictures. Along the back of these pictures, it's got fatalities and all that about it. But you can't read. You can't put it together what it says on the back of the pictures. But from what it said and where it is, this is the time when the culvert collapsed when they were building it. And you see, they were putting all these timbers up to build it. And it all collapsed, and there was people dead on this. So this obviously must be the. I've got quite a lot of these photographs. So there's some more. This is actually down the little lane side of Marks and Spencer's. And these are the kind. This is the kind of corporate work they did. This is the relief corporate, not the big one. Of course, about a few years ago, you went down Peter Street, you probably saw this. And this is the original bridge. It was the original bridge. It wasn't the jail bridge. The jail bridge was here. There were two bridges, this one and that one. And we both saw them underneath, from underneath. And you can see the tracks on there, look. And that was where carts had come across and worn it out. But when was there about 4 or 5 years ago, they wanted to, actually somebody suggested they put a perspex piece on that so people could see it, to view it. But being in one of the main streets, main part, they said, look, if a bus pulled up on it, the black off the tyre would cover the top up, and eventually you wouldn't see anything. So I think it was just a suggestion. Here we are, let's get a bit close at it. And I've just, this is coming up to the end, about 4 or 5 years ago, six or seven years ago, they were doing this piece, and the contractors came, and I saw them down there, so I went down to have a look what they were doing, and they said, in about 12 months' time, we're coming to repair this piece, Albert Street, going that way. We'd already done from Peter Street, this way, towards Ball Lane. So I said to him, well, what are you going to do about the water? Because you've got the marking brook flowing through. And he said, we're going to put 4 or 5 inch pumps or something like that in the bottom here to pump it. I said, well, you don't need that. I was at the Irish Centre at the time, just before I left the Irish Centre, when it closed down. And I said, well, don't do that. Come and see me and I'll show you what to do with it. Because under this culvert goes down Albert Street, but this is corn market here. And there's a sewer comes underneath this and goes into the other one, which is lower down here. So all you've got to do is break it open here, put sandbags across, and all the water's gone. I said, I'll show you what. Anyway, nobody came. So when they started to work, I came down by this station, and I saw this crane with these huge pipes. I went to the guy and I said, what are you doing with these, mate? Well, he didn't want to tell me because he more or less said, well, clear up your kind of thing. Mind your own business. I said, no. I said, what are you doing with them? Because he put a new sewer in. He said, no, these are for drainage. Oh, there they are. See them? Two pipes. They're actually piped from the station approach right up to Albert Street. It cost them just over £22,000 to put these in. There was no need for any of that. I could have done it for 50 pence. So here we are. I'll show you a little bit later on why. This is all the work that they did down below. It's all gone now, all this. But look at it. It's a big culvert, you know, this is. Really. You can run a lorry up. They are. Look at these pipes. No need to put them in. No need to. All you got to do is put a row of sandbags and smash the top of this sewer in, and it ran into the next door. The water ran from where we are, dropped in, and went next door. Going back now to 1950, do you recognise that man? Do you recognise him? This is under the St Peter's Bridge. We started from here, and you see what we had to do in those days, because the river backed up, right up from the river gardens, and it backed up as far as the post office, and then it went up, and it was very shallow then. So what we did was put this stank across with sandbags here, and then all we had to do was break a hole in here and put a pipe right the way down the side of us, and we got rid of all our water. It was dry, so we had no water to play with. It all went next door. And also we could put the gate up at 4th Street, which got rid of the rest of the water that was coming down the brook, so we've got no problem. So there's me poking the... Anyway, on again. But just here, where we started from here going this way. That what you've just been looking at is going that way. We started here, and we put a box in here with coins in and photographs in and things like that. So it's still in there, yeah, for the future. Yeah. Of course, we had boats down there, and not this particular one, and because we had to, this is down Albert Street. And you can see how the water, I mean, this was about 3 foot, and down below there's a weir just about here, so it dropped, so you dropped into about 5 foot. So you couldn't walk that way. Today you can walk a lot, because we've changed it. But what we were doing there was just drilling holes in the roof, and with a pump here, just pumping cement in. Because it was, if we went down there and banged it, it sounded hollow. We used to drill a hole and pump cement in until the electric board found out we were filling all their cables up. So that got stopped. So this boat here, what we use regular, and this we parked it in the council house car park, in the middle of the council house car park. And if we had a group, like from combustion or railway works or people coming to Derby, the big councillors from all over the place come to Derby, one of the things they did, no such thing as safety, health and safety. I used to have to go down here dropping the manhole in the council-sized car park into this, bail it out, because it's all got water in it, cleaned it, round here, put some planking around the outside and put some sandbags on for them to sit on. And then we bring people up with a tilly lamp on, look, tilly lamp, and bring them up. So we'd have 20 or 30 people, and mixed mess with my system. I used to meet at the River Gardens. I'd get 15 people in the boat, bring this up. He'd go to Ford Street with 15 people and walk them from Ford Street down to the post office. I would get to the post office with this boat, and then when we got there, we'd change over and come back. And the things you can see in the COVID in them days. It's weir, actually. If you go down Albert Street in the middle of the night in the 50s, in the middle of the night, because the gullies drop straight in, you could hear this weir and steps. Well, when the river was up, it used to level this off. So we've got a mark here, so it's still a bit there, look.
Yes.
Mark. So if you don't go any farther than that walking in Wellington, it should be dry. You know, you get wet through. But eventually we took that weir out. It has steps there, and this was actually to drive water into the Albert Street to the, was it a couple of mills there. But when we drained the COVID out of our job in the 50s, look at this. We were putting these up. I helped a lot of these, you know, during my first days after I came out of the army, putting a lot of these timbers up, supporting the roof. Because every time there's a crack in the top, no good repairing the crack, you've got to stop it from collapsing.
Yeah.
And you've got trolley buses on the top. And it was all the way down, it wasn't just bits. It's terrible down there, really. You can see how big it is.
Yeah.
It's all for supports. Next door, down Thorntree Lane, the other culvert, which is 12 foot wide, that actually goes down, well, it starts from Ford Street, where the brook is today, and it comes down through the Wardwick and it goes down Thorntree Lane and joins up the culvert at the back of the bus station. So that's another culvert altogether, a relief culvert. That's still there today. But this is all the sewers in the town centre, and they're all like this, all brick. We did actually bricklayers when I first got going. We got the bricklayers coming, more bricklayers coming out of the army and that. We were down here pointing them up, or in fact cleaning them, because the trouble was everything used to hang on the bricks sticking out. It's a terrible sewage. A lot of these have been repiped, but that is Babington Lane. Now, there's a rat, can you see?
Oh.
See him?
Yeah.
And when you come out the culvert comes out round to here and comes out under this cattle market bridge, and where the Fleam is today, it used to run down there. But actually, when it got to here, if you remember there, Charles, there's a culvert, we rerouted it, stopped it going out into the River Gardens, and brought it from the River Gardens down here. But from here, you go back up there. So you can come. So today, you can actually get in at Ford Street, walk down through Bond Lane, the Strand, Victoria Street, down through Albert Street, into the council-sized car park, turn right, halfway down the car park, down through the River Garden. That's why we lost the River Gardens, because we went straight through it. It's come to here, and then instead of going out to into the open here, and down by the station, turn left right there, go along there, round the River Gardens, round the bus station, through Thornbury Lane, through the Victoria Street again, in a different culvert, go along the Wardwick, turn up Curzon Street, off top of Curzon Street, turn right to Abbey Street, to Oxford Road, and then what took me to Oxford Road and Slack Lane, the brook used to come to, that's where the Bramble Brook comes through. You've got, from there, you can get in the big culvert and walk from there under Burton Road, you to Oxford Road, Lowerdale Road, Pear Tree Road, down Princess Street, under Rolls Royce, Osmiston Park Road, Harvey Road, Rainsway, and right out to Borrowash. And I've done that quite a few Sundays, you know, used to overtime job walking the whole lot just to inspect that Corbyn. We're okay. So you can, I mean, that's just in the main one. You can actually walk for about 35 miles. I mean, today, just as you are today, if you've got just a pair of Wellingtons on, we could do, because we've had no rain for a few weeks, you could do a lot of that. But health and safety won't stop. This is the canal bridge, and that's the relief corvette coming in, a bit different now. And this is actually the canal bridge. And that was actually one of the very first iron bridges that we put in for the viaduct. When we took it into Notts Road Depot. Because in them days it was just scrap. But it was kept. It was there for a few years until I went on holiday one day and we was actually doing Albert Street, putting new pavement in. And the bank at the bottom of Peter Street, they've got big skylights for their cellars. Massive, big, long ones. You probably remember them being there. And they were getting a bit catty. So we said, well, are you going to have new skylights? Are you going to put new ones in? They said, no. Can you concrete over? Well, while I was on holiday, somebody decided to cut it up. It's in Albert Street now on the pavement. This thick iron is on the top of the bank. Perfect for the bank, isn't it? And then concrete on the top. When I came back, I said, well, what have you done that for? Well, it did a good job. Now, there's a piece in the museum. If you go in the museum, since I think in Silk Mill, there is a piece of it. And they often say, where's the rest of it? And I said, well, yes. If you bring your metal detectors, come with me. Oh, and if you went along the pavement, you'd be yeah. It's there, definitely there. This is actually Ford Street Bridge. This is the, you know, where the Brook is today, Mark Eaton Brook going in. And that is Ford Street, and that was a very early picture, 1890, something like that. And that bridge is still there, that's the bridge. There it is. And if you stand against that, go down and stand against that bridge and look back, you see the weir in Ford in Full Street, in Ford Street rather, the weir. I used to have people coming, you know, old men sleep at night time during the summer, down here, and there's a little bit here, a bit raised up, so they used to sleep on there. It's a rain during the night, you know, and you can walk, you can see walk down here. I mean, that's what you could do, that's how it would be today if you went down there. And we had all sorts down here, we had loads of filming down there. This was, I forget his name, he was the chairman of Derby Ellison. But these are the bridges, and you can understand why we had problems. This is Sandygate. Look at that.
Oh.
Old, in, I mean, rubbish.
Yeah.
These have come down. And look at the brickwork.
Oh.
And don't forget, we're not talking about something in 1900. We're talking about something in the 50s when traffic was. And because traffic stopped going down the Strand. Because, unless, until you see a little bit later on when a steamroller went down. And there's Sandygate Bridge. This is Sandygate here. That's the cheap side. That's where the museum shop is today. Look. You can see it's open.
That's some Werbergs.
That's some Werbergs there, yeah.
Yeah.
These are the shops here. And of course, when we actually we dropped the water level in the Corvette to do the job, this appeared. And of course, in the old days, when the brook was open, along here, all the way along here, right up to the west end in Ford Street, there were iron rings all the way along. So what were the iron rings for? Boats, aren't they? So boats must have come up as far as this. This is proof of it.
Yeah.
And we found, in this area from here down to the Victoria Street, we found thousands of knob pins. They're about 1.5 inches long with a little bit of wire right around the top. The museum have got a load. I've got some somewhere. And these were pins about 300 years ago, thrown into here. And there's a pin maker, we find out eventually, or 20 years ago, that there's a pin maker in Victoria Street. Because it was called Brookside in those days, not Victoria Street.
What would they use the pins for?
Pardon?
What would they use the pins for?
Pins.
Pins, yeah.
But, well, in the old days, you'd have a pin for anything, wouldn't you?
Tailors, dressmakers.
Dressmakers, anyway.
Yeah.
But there's no, not like we are today with a knob on. We've got a little bit of wire up round the top to make the and we also found pewter spoons. We never found knives and forks.
No.
where we found loads of pewter spoons, and I've got two or three myself. And a little bit farther on, we found hooves and horns, hundreds of them. Because eventually, I mean, they chucked everything in. And we found loads. We was digging. Oh, I'll show you later on.
Well, how was the water cleansed?
Well, it wasn't cleansed, was it? It was filthy.
So did this go... Was it acid water?
This was a brook. Yeah, it was a sewer. That's why they covered it over. Because there's no way in 1850s and 40s could they do it. And this was still here. We found all this. And coins galore. So here we are, us starting the job, and this is St Peter's Bridge, and we're starting, and that's my dad, myself, and my brother, Don. And what we're doing actually, we've drained the water, here we've got no water. We stopped it at Ford Street, put it into the relief culvert. We put a trench across here for the water from the corn market here to come underneath here into the next door. So we've got no water, only the water that rained here.
Yeah.
And what we're doing there is a trial to see how deep the walls was that they originally built. Because we wanted to excavate lower in the base. So that was the start of our job. We'll see you later on. Of course, we put a railway line in, and we borrowed this off the railway, and we put this on. George has made this, and if you remember Peter Street, bottom of the outside the post office in the 50s, can you remember it? That big hole. Big hole there, it's about two years nearly. This is it.
Oh, yes.
Outside the post office.
Yeah.
Well, what we did was we dropped this onto this, built it up like this, and then the small plate actually that fits on here, pushed that down to the start, that was down to Peter Street, jacked it up, was jacked underneath here, slid it over, pushed it over with another one, over the side, onto the rims that we put in, and then put the other one on. Eventually, this is what, this is, and of course, most of it was our family. There was 11 on the job, 9 of them was our family, yeah. And on this particular picture, you see, this is outside the post office. Look at the corbett. I mean, that wasn't very thick there, was it? And you've got trolley buses on the top. And some of the trolley lines were on the actually brickwork itself, and you got a brick and a half. So what we actually do, we was going to put away for a new service in here, you'll see it. But to do that, we got less than the corbett. So we had to excavate at least 3 or 4 feet out of the base. But there's, well, you see, there's me, that's my granddad, that's Jack, that's my dad, who always wore a white muffler, he was the boss, my brother Don, and then we've got George, I've got Kent, Brian, and the crane driver married my sister. So, so it was more or less a family job, yeah. And that's what we did, see the lining.
Yeah.
And can you remember when we had an earthquake? Tremor in Derby in the 54. Well, I was up the back of here because to get bolts in from the top to drop them in for the blokes underneath to bolt them up, you've got to have somebody up the back. And I can remember being up the back there one day when we had that vibration, and I was up there. I thought I was going to be squashed.
Yeah,
I did, honest. There's just enough room for me to be in. So we finished this. All the steel lining, and this crowd down here, we had the archaeologists with us now, they all came, and they're nearly all archaeologists. Of course, don't forget, this was the main, it was all open, and it's, you know, Brookside, called Brookside, the old brook, and of course this here, anything was thrown here, and you know, the archaeologists were there, and every bit that was re-excavated, put it onto skips, the big skips, brought it back, crane took it up into lorries, then go back again for another lot. Every bit that was dug out, was put in, was riddled. And we found coins galore, loads of coins. You know, I mean, we talked about loads, hundreds. And the archaeologists were picking bits up and picking all these things up. And here we are, there's a corbett being completed. And of course, we use these corbetts during the snowing, and we had snow in Derby, because as soon as it snowed, and everything stopped. Factories packed up and people working outside, and they come to work for the council. All you did was you got your shovel, that was your clocking in thing, shovel, and you went in and got paid for snow shifting. We had no problem in Derby with having these big culverts, because this is outside Rambis there, look, into the relief culvert. So all they were doing, chugging it down, every now and again we used to go up to the Ford Street, wind the gate, let 6 foot of water go through, drop the gate, and then it had gone straight out to the river. So we was okay for smoking. There we are, Brookside. This is Victoria Street. I think it's about 1860. This is the church, Victoria Congregational. And the co-op is there, one of the first co-ops. That's Green Lane, and there's a slaughterhouse at the corner there. So we found all those horns and hooves there. Pins were here, and I think it was that one. It was the spoons, and they were all makers. We found out that they were makers of these. This is actually Beckettwell Lane up here, and there's the church, original. I think it's just 1773, but there's the brook coming in, Bramble Brook, coming in there. That's where Ducker Square is today, of course. But in 1939, August, which is before the war, and that's my dad there, a fellow named Jackie Cook, on this sign here, he says vehicles prohibited. No vehicles. So nothing went in there. But the council were actually repairing the road. And so they told Jackie Cook, take a roller down to the Strand. Well, Jackie was the heavy roller driver. Heavy driver. Nobody told him to take a small roller. Take your roller down. So he took his roller down. He didn't see anybody. He'd come round the corner, straight in.
Oh, gosh.
Jackie. He was only a little fella. You'll see him in a moment. And because I know Jackie, Lethal's 62, so I knew very well. And he told me all the story and that. But this is it. And I can remember going down here with my dad, and this is it.
Oh, yes.
This was probably seen somebody's picture in the Telegraph a few times. The trouble was getting it out, because where are you going to run it? You can't run it that way, you can't run it this way, if you go straight in again, wouldn't you? So I'll tell you what they did. So what they did, they actually got it up on timbers, jacked it up, got it to there, and then filled this all in with stone, and then welded plates, steel plates, around here into Cheapside, let it run out onto Cheapside. And that roller is still working, it's still still available in Suffolk. It's in Suffolk, that roller is. There he is, Jackie Cook. Jackie Noon, rather. He was a big driver. He lived on Cherry Trail. Well, we get on to Mark Eaton now. Of course, in the early days, they was talking about putting, because of floods, after the 32 floods, they wanted to get rid of water, and they covered the culvert over and all that, so it had been. So we got that relief culvert was put in the town. The idea was to put the Mark Eaton Brook from Ford Street across the West End part to the Derwent at Mary's Bridge. But I've seen all the plans and things. The problem was when the river came up there, the water wouldn't flow. So they decided to stop it all at Mark Eaton. So pick up the Mackworth Brook, the Mark Eaton Brook, and if they can get rid of that. So they decided to build a culvert from Mark Eaton Lane through to Dolly Park. And this is what they did. And at the Broadway Hotel, this is 125 foot deep. So if you go down the steps, you have to go down, cross, down, cross, down. It's a long way down, 125 feet. But there you are, up at Mark Eaton before they cover it over now. There's the one of them, there's two of these, going into one, just at the back. That one comes from Alistry, and that one comes from Mackworth. So that's a lot of the Mackworth water. Comes down from Prince George Avenue, right across the back, and through into that, and that comes out there. So if you walk up that, you can call it the Mackworth. There's the culvert. Looks quiet there. That's how it probably is, probably a bit more water than that today, but normally it's up at this level, going at about 30 or 40 miles an hour. So it's a bit dangerous down there. So when we went in, we made sure it wasn't thundering or Although we had a thunderstorm once out at up at Porton Mac towards Matlock Way, and we got really some water coming down this way. We have problems in sewers as well. I remember I went to a, I was doing a talk at Littleover about 5 or 6 years ago, and I bought this on. I said, "Oh, this is I'm at Littleover." A gentleman, a policeman, he was a policeman. He used to have a pig farm on the with the Bastard's Wreckies, side of Bastard's Wreck. And he called me up one day, he said, "One of my pigs has fell down the sewer, can you help me?"
Oh, gosh.
So I said, well, come down and have a look. So I went down to him. I didn't know this, that his wife was in the audience this day. And I was like, I'm talking to you, you're his wife. Mm-hmm. And of course, I said a few things I shouldn't have said. Anyway, I said, I went down and see him. There he is, scratching his head. And I said, "What's happened?" He said, "Well, one of my pigs has pushed your top, the manhole top off and fell down the sewer." Yeah. Well, the step iron's coming down, you know. Mm-hmm. So I thought, well, the sewer's, this pig's bound to be dead, you know, ripped to pieces. Yeah. So I get down, I went down, he wouldn't go down, policeman wouldn't go down. This is what I said, you see, a policeman, he wouldn't even go down the manhole. So I went down, there it was, looking at me, shone me lamp. I said to him, "It's all right, he's down here, looks okay. The problem is, this is a sewer, and it ran along here and then went a dip under the canal and then came back up again. So the pig couldn't have gone that way if he drowned himself. It had to go underwater to come back up." So I said, "The only thing we could do is..." So I went to his van and got a rope with some corks on, floated it past the pig.
So you had to go back up there?
Then floated these corks down to the manhole, put a rope on that, and put a bucket on, you see?
Yeah.
A bucket on it, and then pulled it. I had a bloke at the other end, with the bucket on, with the rope on it, and I pulled it here, banging it up the bum, to get the pig to come to me, to get it here.
Yeah.
So we got it to me, the fire brigade had come by then. So we got some hoses. The problem was, the pig was too big.
Yeah.
And this guy said, "Put a rope, this who owned it, put a rope round his neck and pull it out. He'll kill it." And it was impossible to get it up there. Because of the step irons.
Yeah.
So I said, "Well, look, to the fire brigade, could you put a hose on?" I was still down here. Here.
Right.
"Put a hose on, wash it, see if it's injured." But no injuries, hardly any injuries. Anyway, so I said, "Well, blow it." So I let it down again, let it off, and it went back there. We fastened it up, and we went and got a machine and dug a trench out like that. And then broke it open and pulled it out. And that miserable devil never gave us a bit of pork at Christmas. And this woman said that that was my husband. Well, I was a bit blushed. I felt a bit bad. I said, I think he did a few swear words about it.
Maybe.
He's dead anyway, so he's still a little over. Anyone wants to look into the books and find out? This is a problem, some of the problems I had with sewers. And this was, you know, Nottingham Road, top of Rangeway, that building, the top of the Fairy Shop and all sorts. That was tripe at one time, tripe shop, making tripe. We had him to do a talk on tribe, this guy, because it was big. They did all the they did right down to Birmingham, sold the tribe. We had him at Chester Green to talk about tribe, and he said to me one day, and I took these, I knew it was coming up, so I took these photographs with me. So when he was talking, he says, "Any questions?" I said, "Yeah, do you remember me?" He said, no. I said, "Remember when I shut your works down?" And he said, "Yes, you little bugger, was it?" So what happened was, I went up, he got the drains were blocked. I went up and it was only a 6-inch drain at that time. And we couldn't get the drains off, we couldn't even with rods and stuff like that, we couldn't even get anything off. Got no jetting units in them days. So that's me holding that. So we excavated, we got to do it because other people were getting blocked. So we excavated in Nottingham Road down to the sewer, and when we got the length of the sewer open, I went with it with a hammer and just hammered the pipe Well, you know, if you've got nothing in the pipe, it rings.
Yes.
But this went boom, 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 solid. So I cracked the pipe open, and there it was, this fat. And I actually cut it and pulled it out. Look, that is a length of fat off the, what these were chucking into the sewage. Yeah. Look at that. Look at these pieces here. Look.
Yeah.
We bought it into the yard, just showing the programme. And that's where it was. That's fat. So he said, well, I remember you, remember you.
Yeah.
I said, yeah, you didn't get no try. So we went back again to the Corbett. We did the Corbett up to Peter Street, to the Strand, and then back in 1960, I went back there again because we were doing all the jobs in between. And this is where the steamroller went in, because the Corbett goes along there and goes bends. It bends under that building, went round there and like that. It doesn't do that now because when we did this, we straightened it out and it goes straight across there now, under the sports centre. So a lot of the old Corbett's intact now. And this is the brickware that was put in 1939 where the steamroller went in. So the Corbett went like that. And we started there. I don't remember it like this, but there's Saddlegate Bridge.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. This, well, this is the brick wall that we put in, that bend, that sharp bend around there. Yeah. And just over there is another bridge. There's a bridge here, but there's a bridge there as well, an iron bridge. So there's the big, that's in the Strand. We took it all out, all completely out. Didn't save anything. And then we steel lined and then filled it with concrete. So now anything can go down there now today. There's Saddlegate Bridge. And this is Victoria Street when the Corbett had been covered over in the 1850s. This is James's Street, narrow street. This is a toll bridge here into the Woodwick. So if you came from the corn market, you had to pay a toll to come across this toll bridge. That's the Strand up there, that was open, over the, just over the wall there, that was open. And then because the post office was built here. But St James's Street was only about 14 feet wide, up a narrow alleyway. And this is actually a photograph of that same part of the Corbett. This is another bridge here. And this is where it just bends sharply. And this is actually what we found, what we got was, when we pulled, when we were going to build, what, I was talking about building the new car park in Bow Lane, and did some trials, and bones came up. So, but we weren't in the cemetery. Well, that's what we, because we were given some markers put in the, where the cemetery was, and how far it came out, but nobody told us about this. Now this was the part where they buried the dead from Ithel Thieving in Sangam. Mm. But they buried the bodies here. Oh. And all the bodies were here. And we actually, well, when this bloke was doing some drilling, bones came up. Mm. So what we had to do is take a machine in there, excavate with a digger, pick the bucket up and shake the bucket. I don't know if you've seen them doing that on these diggers. Shake it, when it shook down, all our boats were just picking bones up. And we had four or five boxes of bones, and these were all taken to Notch Road Cemetery. But they were all, they should have been burned, shouldn't they? So, but only, a lot of them were only criminals for setting fire to A-rigs and things like that, but there was one. Yeah. And in this part here. And this was actually a little footbridge, only about 4 feet wide, and the reckoned it was there for people walking from Mary's Gate to walk over there to the church rather than walk up to Saddlegate Bridge to walk across. And it was technically not Notch Road Depot, but it was at Iron Bridge. Going back now to where the council house is, that's the council house car park entrance there. You can see the brook. Well, before this was covered over, and when those guys covered, steel lined it. This is dual, it's a dual carriageway down here, Corbett. That was still there to see until about 4 years ago. That landing stage there. And this is the shop tower. Where the courthouse is today here. And this is the Tennant Street Bridge. And it's called Tennant Street because it was a 10th bridge. But I don't know why they call it the Thames Bridge, because there's 11. Well, there's one coming out of the Bramble Brook, as you saw, next to that church, coming this way.
Yeah.
So that's another bridge, and that's 11. So I can't tell it, I know there's 11. So this is Tennant Street Bridge, and that building's still there, just been done up on the corner. Shot tower. Mm-hmm. That's the Castle and Falcon pub, look, corner of East Street.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the buildings and shot towers here, old shot tower. That's how it was. This is 35 feet wide. And on top of this, you've got the island, the big island.
Mm-hmm.
So underneath that island, that's why you have to walk up that little slope coming out of the corn market into the Alban Street. I've got to come down here to come out there. It doesn't come out there no longer. And this is a photograph of the market in Brooklook there, in the river garden, before the council house was built.
Mm-hmm.
There's the dual carriageway, see it? It was two. It don't come out there now, it's sealed off. It comes down there and comes down this way. And we lost the river gardens for that, because we took every bit of this, every piece of this was taken into Knox Road Depot, stored. Even the, I had to put these, well, I didn't take the turtles into Knox Road Depot because we had lots of scrap dealers coming regular for scrap. Because we were doing demolition at the same time, see, we lost these jobs. So I went to Mark Eaton Park and I asked Mark Eaton Park if they could store them for us. And they had a timber shed where the stores are today, where they had the logs in. And he said, we can store them. So they put them into there and they'd be safe. And they actually eventually, over the years, they put logs in. The bark fell off the logs, which they cut up to make posts and things. And it buried them. And one day, 20 years later, when the boundary extended in Derby, before the boundary extended in 74, I was asked for Alastair Park. They wanted to put these in Alastair Park. And so I was asked, Derek, where's the turtles? I said, why? I always used to ask, why? Why? I said, why? I said, well, because they've got to go to Alastair Park. I said, Alastair Park, that's not in the blooming borough. The boundary extension. I said, why don't you put them back in the river gardens? I said, I'm not telling you. So I got a mention from the city engineer then, and he used to call me Derek, but Palmer, come down here and see me. He went in and he said, what's this about these turtles? You know where they are, yet you won't tell them. I said, well, they want to put them in Alstree Park. He said, that's where they're going. And I said, I had an argument with him. I said, look, well, why can't we put them in the river gardens? Because that's not in the boroughs. The borough extended there. Why have they got to go there? They've got to go there. Be trouble. So I had to go. So we went from Mark Eaton Park and they went to Alstree Park. And I often said I'd go up at night time one day and bring them back. This is flooded in 1932 in Victoria Street. This is, look, Woolworths, bottom of Green Lane. This is Albert James Street. It's caused lots of trouble in Derby. The brooks, the two brooks, have got nowhere else to go in. And you can imagine when all those culverts were there, there's stones in, rubbish piling up. When you get a flood, soon pile up, over the top of the comp. I mean, this is shallow here because there used to be a sign on there, 4'1". So it was pretty deep. But you see, this is the Wardwick. Up in the West End, some of the cottages in the courts, up in the bedrooms.
Oh.
It was pretty bad up there. See, Paul Market. There's from the marketplace looking down the corn market. How bad it was in the morning. But of course, when it started to go down in the marketplace, the people used to go on there to watch it, what was going on. And these, it's my dad here, that one. My dad was here at that time, because what happened was, that was Victoria Street up there, look, and you can see the Victoria, it was a foot deep up there, so it was deep here, 4 to 5 feet. The jewellers here, Samuel's here, just here, and what happened, the shop next to it, there'd been a gas explosion, it blew all the windows out.
Oh.
These guys here, what they're doing is picking up jewellery.
Yes.
Yeah. My dad, I said to my dad, did you get any? He said, no, and I don't believe him. I didn't believe him. Anyway, so what they were doing, that's what they were doing, picking up jewellery, until the water went down. But you know, very early on I told you about the big corvette coming through there. And this one out of Cornmarket going underneath it to the next door corvette. Well, this sewer was the one that took the water off. So after when the war finished and we started doing maintenance on sewers and cleaning stuff out, and we were cleaning silt out of the sewers that were there in 1932, because, you know, 6 years later the war started, no labour, so you could only do what you could. So I had a job of cleaning this sewer out. My dad said to me, because he was my foreman then, my boss, don't forget that the gang that you've got tonight, make sure that every bit that comes out, it all came out by buckets. So you passed every bucket and tip it out, because you never know the jewellery. Mm-hmm. There might be still some there. But, you know, honestly, I put my hand on my heart, we never found a thing.
Oh.
We never found anything. That was it. There's the policeman look after as you've gone down.
Oh, yes.
All around looking.
Yes.
Because there's still a lot of jewellery left. Sandy Gate started to go down and started to get. And these are some of the corvettes, and these were when I was at work. We used to have to, you see, they're still flowing, but look at the rubbish in here. And it took, and of course, in the after the war, the first 6 years, there was hardly any work going on for only small pieces for probably a few houses being built here and that, until we started like the big ones like Mackworth. It was all maintenance, getting these sewers. Look at that. Half a mile.
Ooh,
down the corvette. It was there till it rotted. It was there till it rotted. Yeah.
Did you ever pick up any diseases?
No. I haven't known them. And of course, I used to be in charge. I always feel proud of looking at this picture, because when I was in charge, every 2 or 3 years, Mark Eaton Brook was cleaned out. And if you ask anyone that knows the Mark Eaton Brook, it was always clean. Brookwater was always clean 3 years. This actually is on Mackworth Road. That's Moore and Edie's there. It's cottage now. This was a swimming pool, remember? Come down the steps and cubicles for boys on that side. Cubicles for men on this side, but no ladies. No, that's the rule. I've got the ruling for this place. No ladies. I don't know why. They put a weir here, which is still there today. Today, if you stand in this place today, and took a photograph, you would not see half of this wall, because there's actually an arch here. You wouldn't see that, because there's reeds.
Oh,
the
marquee yes.
book is not looked at as anything now today. In fact, if you went to marquee, you could bypass it and send it to Charlie Farm. But we did have a few times. I got a message, Derek, can you come quick to Ford Street? 2 foot of water in the vine. This was the 60s. 61, something like that. 2 foot of water in the vine, pub. I thought, crap, it was. Well, it must be the corvette. Because the two corvettes from underneath, it must be the corvette. But we're actually pulling the railway bridge down in Agard Street. Remember? There. I've been out in the morning, because I was, don't forget, I was a foreman then, so I was telling people what to do.
Yeah.
Been out in the morning, told the contractor, who the machine we've got on loan with us, when it hits this bridge, take it down bit by bit. But we don't want anything breaking on the road. Because underneath here was one of the biggest water mains. And he didn't. He let the lot go. And they smashed the water. Because the water, but you can see it gushing up.
Yeah.
And all the muck, it washes into the gullies, blocked the gullies, and the road came up. And we had this. And there was 2 foot in the vine. Derek, where's the manhole? What can we do with it? Well, I told you about the relief corvette. We've got a corvette coming out of here. The big corvette goes that way. Got a relief corvette coming out here and goes down the Wardwick. And that comes along here. And I know for a fact there's a manhole here. So I went and walking about with this thing, banging it, because I knew where the manhole was. And found the manhole, and that's what happened. There we are.
Oh.
It cost the council about 10,000 quid for this garage and some of the cars and that. There's a lot of money.
Yeah.
If you go down underground Derby, if you go up the Wardwick and come up here, it's not the big corvette, That's the one that goes the relief corvette. This is Kayser Street. So you can see, walk about in Derby. No street names. And these are some of the getting into the source. So there's lots of these places. And of course, what happened was with the floods, that 32, they built the one from Mark Eaton through to Mark Eaton Park. That picked up the Mackworth and the Mark Eaton Brook. But also the other brooks, the Bramble and the Little Over Brooks and all those, had got to be picked up. So what they did in 1935, they started from Borrowash and came up through to Rangeway, up Harvey Road, and got as far as Princess Street at Normington, heading to Slack Lane. And on the way, they were picking all the brooks up. The war started, so everything stopped. There was nothing put in this, no water went in it, only little bits that drained in. So what they did at the Mitre, a lot from there down there, they put seats in.
Yeah.
And this is an air raid shelter.
Oh.
And if we had only about a month ago, we had one lady that was member seeing it. And we had a couple of our guys that come along Tuesday. He remembers it. I brought him the photograph. And these are just posing for a photograph. They come down the steps like.
Yeah.
Safest place in Derby, this one. Yeah. 30 foot underground. That's an air raid shelter. But everybody was frightened about being down there, it was raining.
Yes, yes.
They didn't. They couldn't believe you that there was no water going to come through.
No.
So going back to a bit of old Derby, and originally, before the weirs were put in, right from the Trent, boats used to come up here and come into here. And you've got the Canal Tavern and the cafe, the boat cafe, on Cockpit Hill. The boat cafe, chip shop it was as well. And the boats used to pull up here, and every Tuesdays, I think it's Tuesdays, Thursday and Friday, boats used to leave here for London. So you could get on a boat here to the Trent, and where you went from there, I don't know, but they used to leave here. And so this was the boat place. Now, that piece that come from the Derwent, this is the bus stations here, where just here. So this is actually where. Do you remember the pet shop on the bus station?
Yes.
Opposite, in the Moorage, that manhole is still there today.
Mm-hmm.
And I took this photograph from here, looking that way. Yeah. And that's the manhole. Here is the, and that's still there. That goes back about 20 feet to where the bus station, about 30 feet. That was the corvette, not the corvette, but the archway that the boats used to come through to get through to the cockpit. And because when the bus station was built, it was filled in, and that is still there, and that is still there today. So you can, if you took this photograph today, you'd take exactly the same picture. Underground, we've still got undergrounds as well as the sewers. We've got the lock-up yard, and because in 1953, we pulled this down, that's the police station. And we had three police stations in Derby at that time. We had this one, the one in the marketplace, and one in Bloomfield Street. And Paul Street wasn't there, of course. And what they used to do is bring up here, lock up yard, called it that because of the jail. Charge them, if they kept them prisoner, they'd take them down below, into the cells, and walk through right through to the Guildhall, which was a courthouse. Guildhall was the courthouse. So you can go down below and get underneath. And here we are. But in the early days, the 50s and 60s, before the Tiger Bar extended their lounge, they had this. And they kept asking the council for permission to cover this entrance up. Because what we did, when it goes down there and turns right, it went across the yard to the police station, so we concreted that in, filled it in, left this, but the council kept refusing the Tiger permission to extend the lounge. Eventually they give in, and so on condition that the Tiger put an entrance in their book, so if you go in their main room today, you pull the carpets back, pull the manholes up, you come down here, steps, into here. And you can walk along, and there's two passages, There's 18 cells down below. And you've been on the bridge, have you not?
Yes. Mm.
Here's one of the guys we used to use early days. And because the lights wasn't on there, frightened to death. But these are the passages with the cells in. So at the end of the passage, yeah, we had a barrier where Felix had this, rented it eventually, and put a barrier in so that he couldn't go any farther. Because you can go through here and come up in the guild hall. I mean, you can go to the Tiger Bar now, break through that entrance, come up in the guild hall. Easy. Yeah, so you've got to be careful about what you say, haven't you?
Yes, yes.
But at the far end here, I remember saying to Richard Felix one day, after he'd been doing a few ghost walks, because I was with him for 15, 16 years, I said to him, you know, go to that cell there, Richard. That was full of coffins until about 60s. Solid, full of coffins. Still cardboard coffins, put in there during the war, stored for if there'd been a blitz.
Yeah.
These cardboard coffins could have been used. Mm-hmm. I didn't know the coffins until I said to one of our birds one day, because they used to go down here because of rats. Mm-hmm. He used to go bait, because mm-hmm. in the market, you know, around it.
Yeah. So.
And I went in one day and I pulled one out. Mm-hmm. That's when I saw that it folded out into a coffin, mm-hmm. cardboard. Mm-hmm. So I said, well, let's get rid of these, because they'd all gone damp and gone tied together. Yeah. So we got them all out and got rid of them. I wish I'd have kept a couple, you know.
Yeah.
Honestly,
we could have them today.
Yeah, but anyway, we got rid of them. I told Richard about this. So of course, Richard then, next time, two or three times after, when he was walking down here, and I was with him, I was with the crowd, because I used to go and go in front and perhaps scratch a bit on the wall and stuff like that, you know. he said, of course, in this one here, it was full of coffins. He said, and we never knew what there was for, who put them there, and what there was. He knew what there was, he knew there were coffins to the wall, but he didn't want to say that because that settled people down, didn't he? When he said it was full of coffins, you think, well, there must be about four or five, but there was hundreds in. So she took over this, and this is jail in Frygate, and of course, this is underground. Of course, when we were with Felix, we worked in here like mad. Well, I'd done some work for Felix and never got a penny. I was there until dinner time. Well, when we first started, he was going to join me at Chester Green.
Yes.
And we were going to make a centre of that. Yeah. And I got toy soldiers and all things like that, loads of stuff. And so, you remember that if you go into Dolly Fields, there's some steps go up into a... I had the top part up there, the carnival and the well-dressing stuff. Mm-hmm. And we decided we would have that part of the Chester Green and make it into a unit for... And he was doing Bonnie Prince Charlie and all that stuff. So he got bags of statues and he got bags of costumes. So we went into it. It cost us £3,000. But then when we told them what we was doing, they said the council said, but you've got to have some new toilets. Mm. And that's going to be more. And you've got to have this. Mm. And you've got to have new doors. Oh. And you've got to have this. Oh. Up the price went to about 10,000.
Oh.
So we backed out. And that's why Richard Felix bought the Heritage Centre in Peter Church Yard. We didn't buy it, he rented it.
Yeah.
12,000. Nearly finished. Yeah. Yeah, nearly finished. And so we took that. And then, of course, Richard rented this. Yeah. Had this for us and went on. And we stripped all the walls off here. But Felix, you know, Richard, he was a right lad. All the doors were actually in the museum. So we got the doors from the museum. Next day, he took them to a paint place, and I was stripped. Well, the museum played hell about it. They even do this and do that to him and all sorts. But he did a good thing because he took all the paint was taken off, and all the scratchings were on the original doors with all the names and things. So it did a good thing, really. So he took over this and we used to do ghost walks in here. This is actually the thing that they used to draw and quarter them on. Now this is the original one. But that when Max Craven had to leave I don't know whether he got a sack or he left or not, the museum, it lent a lot of things out, and this was actually £3,500 insurance. So we had to fetch all these back. So Felix had this one taken back. It's in the museum now, and it's got a new one now, made himself, you know, somebody made it him. So the doors was, you know, on the back of these doors, there's a couple of names on there. One's a little guy, a big guy hanging.
Oh.
And then we found out from the Home Office through the papers we got that one was a 14-year-old boy, not a small man.
Yeah. Oh.
Here's a jailer. There's a guy. Of course, if you got a group like yourself today and you didn't like your chairman who was running you,
yeah,
we used to say, well, try them. So they used to try them, find them guilty of something.
Yes.
Not giving them enough time and so. And then take them outside and hang them. But this was stopped. Public health people come in, and health and safety said you can't do this. And yet we'd only got a bit of cotton between the rope and the thing around his neck. But put him on a trolley and pushed him to the hangar. So there's that pig.
Oh yeah.
Shall we finish there?
Oh.
There's the pig. Going up. Right. Right, John. So anybody any questions?
All the water that was going through, where was it cleansed?
It wasn't cleansed at all, it went into the rivers and that sort of thing. It went away, it was in the danger of bad in them days. Come here,
no,
be careful.
Look,
stop it.
Oh my goodness.
It's all right. It's all right.
Anyway, Derek, we'd like to thank you for coming and giving us all a talk. We've really all enjoyed it.
Yes.
I'm very glad to thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Anybody?
Got any questions for Derek?
No. Rats.
I'm sure Ron's got plenty of questions for Derek.
Well, I didn't want to put this in my bag today because I actually got one that ruined on the floor. I went to the ladies' group. Not the gents. The gents were. I went to the ladies' group. I put my bag here. So there. And I put this rat behind my bag. Well, I'd already wind it up.
Yeah.
So,
and it jumped out.
And the lady said, about rats, do you have rats in sewers? And he said, oh yes, of course. And I said, but you need to follow me all over the place, you know. And I just put my hand in my pocket now.
Yeah.
And I said, you do this, and I pressed the button, and this rat ran across. Well, I got a right telling off.
Yeah.
So I don't bring you now. You know, to get rid of those rats, my blokes went to get rid of them. Would you put traps down, put bait down? But rats, you know, after so long, the bait was no good. Arsenic, stuff like that, was no good for them. And what do women have for heart trouble? What do they call that? In tablets?
Warfarin.
Warfarin to kill rats, you know.
Oh, yes.
I miss you texting every day. And she ain't dead. But anyway, they, after so long, you know, they get used to it. So you have to change it every about 3 years. My blokes used to go down with shovels, the spades. Because rats will only go so far. If they've not been farther than that wall, they will not go. They'll walk down to it and they'll turn around and come back. No matter how far it goes, you can't chase them.
No.
They'll only go as far as they... So you just have shovels and spin the shovels down the culverts. Knock it. Oh, yes, that's some fun with rats.
What a
life. The rat that I was most famous for, right, was on North Parade. You know North Parade? Well, when the railway came through underneath here one time, from Frygate. And we got a problem in North Parade with the sewer. It was a dead end. So the only way you could get in to see what the problem was, no cameras at that time, nothing like that, was to crawl up. So I crawled up this sewer. I couldn't turn around, I got to come back out backwards. But I crawled up this sewer. And when I got towards where the problem was, I could see one of the pipes had dropped in. So I could see the problem, but a rat in front of me. And I shouted back to the guy, this rat's going like this. So he's going to, all of a sudden, he's going to fly past me. But I was laying down. And he actually jumped onto my shoulder, ran down my back, and then went out towards where I'd come in, you see. Well, Bill McCoy was there. I said, Bill, if this rat comes towards you, let it go by, or stand aside, let it go by. He kept shouting, not come yet there, not come yet there. I was saving me, pushing myself back out. I got right back out, and then saw it. They went up, another pipe. Pushing it off. But we had photographs of rats in the morning.
You were a brave man too.
In one of my books, I actually put, because eventually we got cameras and jetting units, so instead of having to crawl through sewage, you just put your camera in, it could crawl through, you sat in the van and looked at the screen, so you could see everything.